Good evening and welcome to the Norman Rockwell Museum. My name is Stephanie Plunkett. I'm Deputy Director and Chief Curator, and we are thrilled to have you with us for our Tuesday evening series. We've got a wonderful series this summer, every Tuesday evening at 5 p.m., called Art, Love, and Identity, which is actually a 50th anniversary and inspired by our current exhibition called Woodstock to the Moon, 1969 Illustrated. But we have a very special program for you this evening called So You Say You Want a Revolution, which will focus on the 1960s period in American visual culture with an extremely special guest, Steve Heller. And I'd like to give you a little bit of background on Steve. His background is just extraordinary, and I must tell you that this award-winning historian, designer, and illustration historian has really set the bar for so much scholarly research that is being done today, inspired by Steve. So to give you a little bit of background, Steve is the preeminent interpreter of published art and design. He was an art director at the New York Times for 33 years, originally on the op-ed page, and for almost 30 of those years, in the New York Times Book Review. Currently, he is the founder and co-chair of the MFA Designer as Author Department at the School of Visual Arts in New York, and he is special consultant to the president of SVA for new programs. I was very fortunate, I have to say personally, to benefit from Steve's scholarship when I was a student at SVA, which is some years ago now. But Steve would come in to lecture regularly at a program that was called Illustration as Visual Essay. And that was an MFA program that inspired artists to think about creating illustrations based upon personal narratives. And Steve's lectures on illustration, visual culture, design were so inspirational to all of us, and for me personally in the field, to be sure. For 10 years, Steve was also director of SVA's Modernism and Eclecticism, a History of American Graphic Design Symposiums, which brought masters in the field together to discuss topics as broad-ranging as racial stereotypes in American popular culture and art, experimental type design, design and censorship, and the history of the visible language, among other themes. With Seymour Quast, who was just here recently, he has directed Pushpin Editions, a packager of visual books, and with his wife, Louise Feely, who is here this evening, and an amazing designer, he has produced over 20 books and design products for Chronicle Books and for other publishers. For over two decades, he's been contributing editor to Print, iBaseline, and ID magazines, and has contributed hundreds of articles, critical essays, and columns to other design and culture journals. As editor of AIGA, Journal of Graphic Design, he published scores of critical journalistic writers on design, and he's currently the editor of AIGI Voice, and continues to help build critical vocabulary for the field. Steve is the author, co-author, and editor of over 100 books on design and popular culture. He recently wrote the preface for the newest reissue of Norman Rockwell's autobiography, which is called My Adventures as an Illustrator, and we have placed that preface on your chairs, which you'll find, I think, a very interesting read. He's currently completing Iron Fists, Branding the Totalitarian State for Faden Press, which is an analysis of how the major dictatorships use graphics to propagate their ideologies. That's gonna be interesting, yeah. We have been very fortunate here at the Norman Rockwell Museum to include Steve's commentary in several Norman Rockwell Museum catalogs, including American Chronicles, The Art of Norman Rockwell, Witness, The Art of Jerry Pinkney, Ishvan Banya, Stranger in a Strange Land, and others. Steve's produced or been curator of a number of exhibitions, including Art Against War, The Satiric Image, Painters as Cartoonists and Caricaturists, and The Art of Simplicissimus, Germany's most influential satire museum magazine. He has created many conferences at the School of Visual Arts, including How We Learn What We Learn, devoted to the future of design education, and the AIGA's Looking Closer, Graphic Design History and Criticism. Among many honors, he is the recipient of the AIGA Medal of Lifetime Achievement and the Art Directors Club Hall of Fame Special Educators Award. We're so honored to have you, Steve, and thank you very much for being with us.
When Stephanie asked me to give this talk about illustration of the 60s, I agreed not simply because I have a great respect for her and this museum, which I think is a wonderful oasis in this neck of the woods, but I wanted to contradict the old adage, if you can remember the 60s, you really weren't there. I grew up during and vividly recall, well, most of it. So this is the description of the talk. And if you're sitting here now after reading all of that, you either have a healthy interest in the period or you are exhausted from walking around this beautiful place and need a rest. So enjoy, and I apologize if I make you even more tired. I'm one of the millions of American post-war baby boomers. My generation reaped the benefits of our parents having survived the Great Depression, World War II, and all the prosperity that came with America's victory. I enjoyed the freedom to follow a career path that was not dictated by wartime austerity, and I would ultimately be defined by the 60s. The cute one is me. I wanted to be an artist. I wanted to be a commercial artist, but an artist nevertheless. In the back of comic books were ads like this, promising that anyone with a modicum of talent, like me, could, with instruction by the masters, become as famous as Norman Rockwell, who personified illustration and commercial art. I know someone else here, Elwood Smith, who took the course, and enough said. I was, however, just as inspired by techniques of the period like this kind of illustration, which I aspired to do, and it seemed to be a calling to me. The 60s was not a monolithic decade. For me, there were different compartmentalized 1960s, neatly divided into relatively equal parts, and I call the first part the Rockwell era, and you're all surrounded by some of these. Rockwell was something of an American 20th century cross between Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo. His paintings may not have achieved the same status as The Last Supper and the Sistine Chapel, but there is no denying that there was an iconic power in their complexity and a kind of American religiosity. He was considered America's storyteller. On the covers of the Saturday Evening Post, Rockwell's art was the defining narrative. His most memorable work may not have been created during the 60s. It was more the 30s, 40s, and early 50s. But his post covers had a calming effect on the masses at a time of Cold War and hot national turmoil. These covers validated everyday life and every man and provided an escape from the stark realities of the times. They also were the aesthetic against which a younger generation of illustrators rebelled. The problem for me was not so much Rockwell's earnest attempts at American propaganda. The post covers were, in general, sanitized vignettes of a mythical America, many produced by Rockwell wannabes. It was the magazine for the status quo American. The realism that pervaded illustration in the 50s, influenced in large part by Rockwell's work, was reduced through the demands of advertising and editorial illustration to commercial mediocrity. For many, the 60s began with JFK's election. marking a temporary end to a toxic age of Senator Joe McCarthy's Red Scare that branded progressives as un-American, that was symbolized by the anti-liberal Richard Nixon, whose Rockwell portrait made him more benign than he was or would later become, or that he appeared in the famous televised debates. The 60s was explosive. Even JFK could not put a stop to Jim Crow indignities heaped on black Americans in the South or the North. And while illustration was benign, who could forget photographs like this? The 60s revolution marked the rise of the nonviolent civil rights movement, the demands for equal justice, the same ones that are threatened today. This would inspire many artists, including Rockwell himself. In 1964, a year after he actually resigned his over four-decade association with the Saturday Evening Post over restrictions on his need to inject political content into his work. This painting, titled The Problem We All Live With, also known as Ruby Bridges, ran as a Look magazine cover centerfold and became an intense visual testament of racial struggle in the United States. In addition to the civil rights, the late 50s and 60s was a threatening time for everyone who foresaw the end game of the nuclear arms race. Frequent atmospheric and underground tests, regular duck and cover trills were frightening. It gave rise to other styles and content of illustration as well. Although clinical schematic illustrations like this belied the idea that humanity was at risk, it suggested with precautions, nuclear attack was survivable. Art like Ben Shahn's poster for Sane indicates the direction of American illustration away from literal, romantic, and sentimental realism. This is an example of where serious ideas were more powerfully expressed through abstraction. Illustration styles had already veered away from the Rockwellian influence early on. In the early 1950s, Walter Ulner's Bauhaus training revealed modernity at work, very streamlined, very simple, very direct. It was an age of pop art, too. But before Andy Warhol revolutionized art, he was an illustrator. And here are two of his magazine covers for Interiors magazine. He also did I. Miller shoe advertising. The 60s marked a time of shifting sands. Abstraction was accepted in the illustrative design world. For me, however, the 60s was more visceral. The East Village was near where I lived and hung out, and went to Gem Spa for egg creams, which neither had egg nor cream in them. That's me. I found this photo by accident at the New York Times photo file. I stole it. I was going home after an all-night paste-up session at the East Village Other, which you'll see later. The 60s was about growing out of my tweens into my teens and the influence of art, music, politics, and sex. Again, I'm the cute one. It was about increasing protest against the war in Vietnam and the increasing confrontation between police and National Guard with protesters. It was about the rise of feminism and awareness of equal rights. It was about music as an agitational force. This is from Woodstock, which turns 50 this summer. Music influenced many things, including illustration and typography. Victorian lettering took a psychedelic turn in 1967 when Victor Moscoso turned up the visual volume. In San Francisco, the counterculture prevailed, hallucinogenic drugs were plentiful, and rock and roll, well, rocked and rolled. Illegible typefaces, vibrating colors, and antique illustrations comprised a rebellious visual language that communicated to those stoned enough to see through the purple haze. Moscoso created some of the most emblematic images of the 60s. I could actually read this poster, and I never did drugs. Now I miss it. Rick Griffin was influenced by Native American culture and the California surf scene. He produced psychedelic poster art album sleeves, and logos of such brilliance that they are among the primary images associated with Jimi Hendrix, the Grateful Dead, and other legendary performers. Back at the beacon of the middle of America, the Post, it was a change in two. Herb Lubalin, who is supposed to be depicted here, although it's not him, was hired to bring the magazine's design into the 20th century, and he did. The 60s was the sum of its parts. But one thing is certain, the times they were a changing, and revolution was a brewing. In the illustration universe, modern art movements like surrealism and expressionism were informing a new kind of magic realism aesthetic. And now I have to take a swig of this wonderful water in a milk container. It tastes like milk, and it's good for you, too. René Magritte was the hero of many up-and-coming 60s illustrators, including Dick Hess, who was an acolyte of Magritte's styling in the mid-60s. I have labeled the early through late 60s as the anti-Rockwell era. Although it is a fair observation, it is not entirely true. Rockwell was in the mind, if only as a counterpoint to illustrators like Robert Weaver, who did this picture, the most influential of the new breed of late 50s and 60s of the expressionistic and impressionistic artists. He was wonderful, amazing, and a teacher who taught with me, and I hope taught Stephanie before he passed away. Weaver was a representationalist. Fluidly drawing with paint was his métier. He also asserted that this was a time when illustrators were asked to illustrate the unillustratable, when psychology and emotion had to be addressed through symbolic, metaphoric, and expressive methods. Robert Andrew Parker, who lives in Cornwall, Connecticut, or Cornwall Bridge, was another significant paradigm shifter. His expressionism was simple and emotive, though representational. In the late 1980s, I authored a book on the new illustration and its progenitors. I dedicated the book to Robert Weaver. He was one of the leaders of a very diverse assortment of artists who rebelled against sentimental realism. Magazines such as the Swiss-based Graphis published his work and spread its gospel through other artists and designers. Print magazine was another chronicle of the new illustration. Sadly, it ended its publication as a print magazine over a year ago, and just today ended its life period. It included illustrators of many different varieties, including Barbara Nessam and Jackie Morgan, among the few women in this traditional boys' club. Other young ones included Daniel Mafia, who combined classical and contemporary tropes, and Jean-Michel Fallon, whose symbolic little man was a surreal cartoon interpretation of the inner self. The most important alternative to Rockwell was Pushpin Studios, co-founded by Seymour Quast, who did these and whose whimsy, childish expressionism, and primitive line helped define the shifts away from romanticism. He was here last week. I hope some of you got to see him. Quast's work was current yet timeless. His art was not tied to any particular period, yet defined his own. Like his co-founding partner, Milton Glaser, many of you may know, who did the I Love New York logo, Pushpin introduced an overall style comprised of individual personal methods. The studio was akin to the Beatles of illustration. Together they made magic. Individually they had their own personalities, like Ringo. And Glaser appeared on many mainstream publications like Life, doing this kind of psychedelic approach. Glaser's ubiquity was incredible. And though his approaches changed regularly from psychedelic to many other forms, Pushpin's art and design was actually quite coherent. They were like the Beatles, I said. They were always experimenting and leading the way. And speaking of music and the Beatles, the breadth of the Beatles' influence was wide. The Sgt. Pepper cover created by Peter Blake was an illustration that goes into the annals of contemporary art history, not just illustration. Art, design, and culture was radically altered, arguably like no other time in history. And Bob Dylan was both an instigator and a catalyst for this. And Milton Glaser's Dylan poster, a combination of a Marcel Duchamp self-portrait and a reinterpretation of a Persian miniature, is icon worthy. It's also for sale at an antique store on Route 7. The colorful nature of psychedelic art even emerged in black and white advertising for the groups at the Fillmore East, where I always had a front seat folding chair because my office was in their building. And I got to see everybody. Soon I'll forget it all. Illustration was going topsy-turvy. This is Peter Max's Panopticon Mandela, created for the Bettman Archive, the leading source for all retro art that was being incorporated into 60s illustration. Avant-garde magazine, although having to live up to a high bar in that title, because once you become avant-garde, you're no longer avant-garde, was showing that illustration needn't be literal to be illustrative. And although this book, designed and ostensibly written by Quentin Fiore, did not have a direct impact on illustration, it inspired visual artists to look towards the future and find the import of their work on a much grander scale than what had come before. Not all, but many 60s illustrators used their talents to advocate for causes. This coming animation was by Milton Glaser, and its meaning is pretty obvious. Walt would have been very unhappy. Civil rights issues were even more critical than ever. It was not just Jim Crow South that discriminated. It was the liberal North, too, with redlined real estate districts and other subtle forms of racism. African Americans had outlet through art and design. In this case, Emory Douglas, the main illustrator for the Black Panther Party newspaper, developed an unmistakable graphic language that spoke picture to power. And this was an issue of the famed Pushpin Graphic by Seymour Quast, which combined the cliches of antebellum South with a catalog of black civil rights workers who were murdered by white supremacists. It starts out where he shows the stereotype and the worker who was shot with a little hole going through their head. The Georgia Peach and Martin Luther King.
It was actually die cut.
Die cut.
Yeah.
Frankly, Scarlett, I don't give a damn about racism. And then the end piece is the March on Washington and the end of Southern stereotypicality. Protest art was a fashion for some and a message for others. It had a long history. Protesting war has been a long and intense theme. This is Robert Miner's illustration. That was produced during World War I, but resonated with the 60s graphic commentators. And this is just one of many songs that addressed this by Buffy St. Marie.
He's been a soldier for 1,000 years. He's a Catholic, a Hindu, an atheist, a Jain, a Buddhist and a Baptist and a Jew. And he knows he shouldn't kill, and he knows he always will kill you for me, my friend, and me for you.
It was called The Universal Soldier. George Gross, who captured the decadence of Weimar Germany and attacked the rise of National Socialism, was resurrected as an inspiration to the new illustration. Seymour Quast introduced irony to protest art, building on the cliches of advertising. David Levine offered up a healthy dose of political ridicule. You may remember Lyndon Johnson having an operation and showing his scar to the press. That scar is in the shape of Vietnam. And the New York Review of Books, which started during the newspaper strike when the New York Times couldn't produce a book review, also became a clarion for political protest. Robert Grossman, who passed away last year, introduced the vintage airbrush tool as a means to make unique imagery and took this jab at Lyndon Johnson. Carl Fisher's Spirit of 76 announced the coming revolution. George Lois used Esquire magazine covers as political posters, usually with a stark, eye-catching image that sold the principal story inside. Meanwhile, another kind of civil rights war was taking place with migrant workers. Sound familiar? Paul Davis used his incredible skill as a painter to capture the sincerity and gravitas of the farm workers' plight in California. Brad Holland, who was my mentor, would become known for his New York Times drawings. He created a poster on his own to rally support for the police massacre of prisoners who were petitioning for better conditions at New York's Attica prison. Robert Grossman had a field day with Richard Nixon and his gang in this Emperor's Got No Clothes illustration. As this portrait of Nixon and Henry Kissinger makes clear, at the time, Nixon was lying about his involvement in Cambodia, and soon the cover-up of the Watergate break-in brought him down. Nixon was eventually forced to resign, but not before Vice President Spiro Agnew was deposed for corruption. For 25 cents apiece, I bought dozens of the 1962 magazine that I found on used book tables at local bookstores and Greenwich Village stores. I'd cut them up and use the type ornaments, dingbats, and whatever else I could salvage from my own layouts and magazines that I had done. This one is called Monocle, and it was edited by Victor Navasky and illustrated by all the people I've spoken about, plus Paul Davis, John Alcorn, and others. The two major magazines to present the new illustration at that time were Ramparts and Evergreen. Both were art directed to optimize the power of image and text in the service of opposition to the government. Art directed by a dear friend of mine who unfortunately passed away, Dugald Stürmer. And even Norman Rockwell got into the act with his portrait of Bertrand Russell, who was the founder of the United Kingdom's Ban the Bomb movement. Tommy Ungerer showed that with a few well-placed lines and dabs of color, ideas could be powerfully expressed. Paul Davis's virtually religious painting of Che Guevara captured a spirituality that made it one of the most reproduced images of the age. Strident caricature is Edward Sorel's métier. Here, his commentary on the 1968 election showed that the establishment, from liberal to extremist, still controlled the body politic. One of the features of the late 60s illustration was a return to vintage revolutionary icons. The Bolshevik poster from 1917 had an impact on the 1968 cover of Rat. One of the most familiar of the anti-war icons was Lorraine Schneider's poster. Its tone was not confrontational, but in a way informational. War is not healthy for children and other living things. And this, again, by Seymour Quast, derived from a 19th century poster, and it couldn't help but trigger emotions. War is good business, invest your son. Tommy Ungerer did a series of anti-war posters that was more demonstrative in its graphic power and strongly effective. And with war as the 60s reality, Ron Cobb looked to the future if a contained war got really out of hand. He says, there's a rumor going around that we won. Drugs was the 60s hallmark, and psychedelic illustration, here for the San Francisco Oracle Underground Press, was the state of the art. The conventional magazine layout was sacrificed for a new visual language. This included mystical imagery and naturalistic typography. It was ultimately turned into a marketing tool, as most things that are original do, like pleated jackets. And even mainstream advertisements pilfered the youth culture aesthetic, albeit badly. Now we come to the sexual revolution part of the 60s. Playboy began in the 50s, but evolved into rich soil for the new illustration. This cover, art directed by Art Paul, in a Moscoso psychedelic style, is an appropriated work. Art Paul was a fantastic art director who gave work to a lot of great illustrators. I Magazine was a Hearst publication meant to be a little more edgy for the new teen young adult audience than Mademoiselle. This cover, while coy, is also a major step for a mainstream magazine to talk about birth control. America knew the sexual revolution occurred when it hit the cover of Time. One of the stories was about my own publication, the New York Review of Sex and Politics. Brad Holland did these illustrations. They engaged art in a way that was not used at the time. They were neither sexual nor erotic, but they had a sensual aura. The NYRSNP was an offshoot of the more political cultural underground 60s press. And I was 17 and arrested for it and had to spend the evening with the prostitutes in the holding cell where they pulled on my ponytail. Mad Comics took considerable liberties with taboo subjects of the 50s, forcing what was known as the Comics Code, which prescribed content into a narrow, sanitized zone. Then in 1968, Underground Comics attacked the peremptory values of a conservative society that less than a decade earlier had imposed these strict rules of conduct on its youth and on its publishers. R. Crumb was no Rockwell, but he was the most prolific of the underground comic artists and the most outrageous. He just turned 75. The underground press was far from Rockwell as you can get. The drawings, illustrations, and the like are the precursors of today's graphic novels, which are extremely powerful and popular. They were raw, ribald, and ridiculing. This is by Kim Deitch. Underground comics were a challenge to the prudish comic code, the self-regulating body that attempted to keep anything that could offend out of comic books. This is Spain Rodriguez, who also did Trash Man. Underground illustration routinely pushed the limits of accessibility, either in terms of content, art, or both, or even legibility. This was by an artist named Fred McGubgub, who did commercials for TV very much in the same way this particular cover was done. And this was one of the first publications I ever worked for, the avatar. As active protests against the government increased, underground papers like The Rat took on a bigger role as politically suspect and often harassed for their contents. Police were always at their doors. For the undergrounds, a bold mixture of wit and graphic virtuosity, often in pen and ink with added mechanical color, was called for by the cheapness of the printing. These were all newsprint. This is Brad Holland. This is another well-known and infamous one called Air Pirates. It was a collective of illustrator comics artists who borrowed styles from the past. In fact, the publication's principals were named in a lawsuit when Disney, Walt Disney, alleged, among other things, that a parody using Disney characters in unsavory positions was copyright infringement, trademark infringement, and unfair competition. The few issues of Yellow Dog offered little beyond drug-influenced vignettes, scatological humor, and some work by R. Crumb. Crumb illustrated the covers. When Zap One premiered, Victor Moscoso and Rick Griffin were among the most prominent graphic artists in the San Francisco rock and roll scene. Zap One was the beginning of the underground comic book, again, which leads evolutionarily to the graphic novel. Originally, Zap Comic was just going to include Moscoso and Griffin's collaborative work. They said, we were already doing our respective drawings when we saw Zap One and when Crumb started selling it on Haight Street. It became a very influential piece for all sorts of artists that are seen today on television, in books, and in film. It also leads to 1969, where another important event happened in the mainstream, and that was the conception of the op-ed page of the New York Times. It was thought about and conceived in 1969, and it started in 1970. And I'm going to show you just a little video that tells its history, narrated by yours truly. I'd like to say I wrote the music too, but I didn't.
I wanted readers to say, boy, those editors at the Times, they're so smart. What I did not want them to say was, gee, those people at the Times, they can afford to buy the best art.
On September 21st, 1970, the New York Times premiered a new section called the Op-Ed, or Opposite Editorial Page. The title implied both its physical location and editorial position. It was a page without editorial precedent, and its unique artwork, by a repertory of politically savvy illustrators and cartoonists, made it even more distinctive.
What we wanted for artwork on the page was not the traditional political cartoon.
Silverstein soon hired a brash, young, witty cartoonist illustrator turned art director, Jean-Claude Suarez, who began his career in the 60s underground press and designed various counterculture periodicals. His mandate at the Times, to establish the page's graphic personality.
I knew the history of political art very well, and I'd examined what was being used at the time in newspapers. They were mostly syndicated cartoons. They were kind of, they were meant to appeal to the largest number of people.
Suarez drew inspiration from 19th century newspaper methods. Like the linear engraving style of Thomas Nast, the symbolic acuity of Daumier, and the surreal vocabulary of Gégé Granville and Gustave Doré.
It was time for a big change, for the illustrators to be influenced not by cartoons as much as by movements in art, like surrealism, and especially Dada, which was my favorite. I wanted the art to be well drawn, and I wanted to create some kind of emotional reaction.
The op-ed style sidestepped typical editorial cartoon cliches for more expressive, often personal, introspective symbolism. The art was making a mark, thanks in large part to the Watergate scandal.
For about a year and a half, from the time that the burglars were arrested until the resignation, we had food for stuff every day.
Brad Holland was one of the regulars on the page who Suarez knew from the underground press.
I had a theory that you ought to just treat the art and the text as two separate elements that went together. In fact, the very first article that I was given to illustrate for the op-ed page was a two-part article about welfare. And the first one, I had an idea of a bunch of faces that were in the sky and they were crying and the tears were like rain falling into a big fire down below. Second part, I wanted to treat welfare as if it were an addiction. So I did this picture of a junkie who was feeding mouths in his arm. This was a comment on the welfare society.
Spasmore finished drawing and it was done on speculation. No one ever assigned it. He just did it. And he brought it in. He said, I don't know if you're gonna like this or not. And it turned out to be, you know, the Watergate drawing.
Op-ed artists were not political cartoonists in the conventional sense, but they were political artists that shot barbs at their prey without fear or favor. And unlike conventional cartoons, the graphic commentaries on the page allowed the readers to make their own interpretations.
Things don't have to be instantly recognizable. You don't have to understand something the minute you look at it. Often you give somebody a metaphor for something and it just sits in their head for a few years until something, some circumstance in their life unlocks it. Some people get it and some people don't, and some people will get it and some people never will.
The Cold War provided a steady stream of illustrators fleeing the Soviet bloc. They were particularly skilled in the art of graphic subversion.
So if you want to see the rest of it, this is the URL. I'm sure you'll all remember it. Or you could just look on op-ed at 40 in Google. I don't use Google myself. I think it's sinful. But the illustrators who worked for the page really did set a tone for how the post-60s sensibility would be presented. It was about concept. It was about thinking beyond the words that were given to you and interpreting those words. So this was Eugene Mihescu, who was one of the Eastern Europeans from Romania who came over. Oddly enough, he went back to Romania and became an ultra-right-wing politician. This is Brad Holland again doing a really brilliant piece on the oil crisis and who was benefiting from it. And this is just such an obvious idea about oil, but nobody had thought of it up until that point. Bob Bleckman, who is shown here, is shown at this museum, was a major contributor, and at 88, he's still contributing to the New York Times Magazine section. And to end with, 1969 marked the demise of the Saturday Evening Post. So 50 years later, this museum is, or I'm sorry, that year this museum begins. The Saturday Evening Post had outlived its times, and Rockwell had outlived the Post. He had already left his 40-year sinecure for the pages of Look magazine and turned more of his attention to social issues, including war, race, and poverty. Illustration had become, by virtue of the times, less entertaining and decorative and more concerned with graphic commentary. And being in this room is quite a special treat, to have all of this work that basically does reflect America in many of its stages and the artist who reflects America in many of his stages. So thank you very much. Well, African Americans were not introduced into commercials until then, and one of them was a beer commercial, and the only show that had a African American star on it was Diane Carroll.
That's right.
Well, I see One big difference is, I would argue that much more can be shown today, particularly on television, particularly because of cable, and therefore it extends into, well, it started with film and literature. I mean, there was a lot of censorship. I was the art director for Grove Press when I was 20, and many of its books were censored. And its film, I Am Curious Yellow, was censored. And censorship doesn't happen anymore. The publication that I published at 17, New York Review of Sex, we were taken off the newsstands until we won in court. So every, what we don't have now is security in our future. Censorship isn't the issue as much as it once was. It's more the attitude. That book, Iron Fist, that Stephanie mentioned, actually was done. And my next book coming out is called The Swastika and Other Symbols of Hate in an Age of Extremism. So I think we've made major strides in terms of what people are can be shown and what people have tolerance for. And I really want to stay away from talking about the man who should be nameless. But just that Access Hollywood tape is a perfect example of what you can get away with. It was just a lot of, some of it was just weekend painters, and some of it were very serious painters, but they would be down University Place and they would be throughout Greenwich Village, but they were not illustrators. Illustration was a very specific profession with very different goals in mind, and the art world per se was at odds with illustration, which is ironic because people like Rauschenberg, Claus Oldenburg, Warhol were commercial artists prior to their fame and ubiquity as art. I mean, there was an imbalance to be sure, but there were more female illustrators coming up through the ranks who were doing very strong political work. Frances Jetter, Anita Siegel, Diana Bryan, a whole bunch of people. And now there was Anita Kunz, who I think has been here. It was the beginning of women taking a stronger role, but it was definitely male dominated. The page ultimately, it was almost at all times edited by men, except when I was there, it was edited by Charlotte Curtis, and we did not get along. But that'll be in my memoir. Well, let me be honest. I took out the things that I didn't think would be appropriate here, not knowing who the audience was.
So among illustrators, is there a...
Among illustrators, there is no limit except what will be accepted, which is true about any art. And artists are expected to push the boundaries as far as they can. And you know, it is being done more and more on cable TV than any place else. But you know, aesthetics can be pushed to the point of what we would call ugly. Content would be pushed to the point of we would call radical. There are all sorts of things. There's blasphemy. I mean, these were terms that were used that today don't seem very relevant. But there is certain levels of taste and appropriateness. And I think most people who are responsible go to a certain limit, or if they feel that it's not going to be heard, seen, or thought of, will go over that limit. I think anything that strikes, as Brad Holland said in the film, anything that strikes a chord,
no matter what medium it is, or what book it is, what word it is, will have an impact. And we are a more visual society, and we don't have much patience. So Snapchat or Instagram stories are things that everybody looks at during the day. And I think illustration still can make some people reflective or emotionally touched. I mean, I was looking at some of this a lot over the last few weeks, and it brought back a lot of feelings. And I look at contemporary work. I have a book coming out called The Illustrator with Toshin in about a week or so, and it's 100 illustrators. And a lot of that work is also quite moving and meaningful. So I think it's all part of our diet. Well, parody works well because you're familiar with the cliche.
Yeah.
And so it opens the first door. But there's a lot of humor I see. I mean, there's still great cartoons in The New Yorker. And humor is more an active, I think humor in art tends to be passive. And humor in TV, like comedians getting driving cars, drinking coffee, you know, we sit there and laugh our heads off. So I think physical humor and live humor and political or social still has a great propagandistic effect. And I use propaganda in the positive sense.
May I add a note? With the celebration of the 50th year landing on the moon, I have several New York Times, and I took them to a friend's house gathering a few days ago, and with their 12, 13-year-old grandchildren. Now, what was interesting, in the New York Times, that was 10 cents. The Daily News and the Post was 8 cents. But the illustrations, or all the ads for the department stores, were all illustrations, except for Corvettes, and they had a photograph. And the lady friend of mine was an illustrator, now Lord and Taylor, and they would have a house model who would wear the clothing that they would do the quick sketches for and so forth, a different time.
Just a piece of trivial fact to end this all. Do you know what EJ Corvette stands for?
8 Jewish Korean veterans.
Yes.
What?
11 Jewish Korean War veterans. Well, comics were always an easy read. I mean, I used to read Classic Illustrateds instead of going through Dostoevsky's 399,000-page book. You know, so there's always been that. But, you know, the graphic novel has to be laid at the feet of both Will Eisner and Art Spiegelman. And once Art Spiegelman got a front-page review in the New York Times Book Review, in part thanks to yours truly, and won the Pulitzer Prize, everything changed. And people's proclivities to read pictorial literature just exploded. It happened at the right time. Television was boring. Cable hadn't really hit the market yet. So I think it was just the perfect storm of lack of media and new media. Thank you very much.
Thank you.